Good morning and happy Sabbath, church family. If everybody will come in from the foyer and maybe we can also close the doors with all the noise. Thank you. We have announcements, video and everything right now. So please come in because we've got a couple of important things to share with everybody. Nobody is shutting the doors back there yet. Notice announcement number one, farewell for Pastor and his family next Sabbath. If you haven't seen it, there is a card out in the foyer on the little desk. Please sign it. We have potluck next week. Please join us. Please bring your food. Family art night coming up. We've got a nominating committee announcement. Coming up, and then we'll have some more stuff on what's going on at the school.
Good morning. So, nominating committee is in session, and I just wanted you guys to know that we are asking the Holy Spirit to go before us and to be with us. In our sessions, we are having our prayer sessions and seasons of prayer before we start, asking the Holy Spirit to impress upon us and impress upon you. We're trying to do something a little bit different, not that it hasn't happened before, but I just haven't seen it happen for a while, where you guys are going to get a phone call and be asked to do something special, but not to give us an answer right away, to give it a couple days and to pray about it. You might be being presented with something new and that you need to be able to see if what all is expected of you or what our church does maybe differently than another church might do with asking you to do something different with that job. Anyway, I just would like to encourage you too as a church to be praying for the nominating committee, be praying for the members. We want to be able to pull together a strong force in this Klamath County to be able to witness and to evangelize. So, thank you.
Thank you, Gretchen. I found that very encouraging. At this time, make sure you read all the announcements in the bulletin. At this time, we will have a short video about Vacation Bible School, personal ministries from the church and the school. We're working together on this. And then the principal afterwards will come and explain some more.
Has great music, and you're going to love the Thunder Island songs.
Jesus is always with me. Jesus is always with me. Jesus is always with me. Jesus is always with me.
Come with us as we learn about amazing sea creatures and the famous turtles on Turtle Cove.
Hey, this is where we are right now. This is Turtle Cove, where kids learn that Jesus is always with them.
Here at the Cove, you will join a marine biologist on an expedition to learn about creatures that live in the island jungle.
And the sea creatures that live just under the ocean's waters. Every day, you will explore the island with Surfer Rocky.
But that's not all at Thunder Island. Look over there at the fun places to explore. Coconut Cafe.
Yep, that's where I got this cool, refreshing drink.
They have some amazing menu items that will be refreshing on a hot day like this at Thunder Island.
Coral Beach, just over there, has cool games that everyone will enjoy.
There's the Sandcastle Craft Shop.
Whoa, I really love the Sandcastle Craft Shop.
Painting, gluing, cutting.
Oh, yeah.
You will love the Scuba Shack. The scuba instructor explores hidden messages.
And teaches you how to communicate with God.
Exploring Cascade Falls is a really amazing experience.
Maybe that's where the thunder sounds come from.
Cascade Falls is a perfect, cool spot to hear a Bible story.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Wait, did I mention there's a message in a bottle?
No.
Yeah, a real message in a bottle.
Your kids are going to love the Thunder Island VBS program.
I love Vacation Bible School, and I know kids have a lot of fun at it. And the last one that we did, all of our teens who helped were like, hey, let's do that again. It's so much fun. So be planning July 8th to 13th. If you would like to participate in some way, we are looking for group leaders, people to help with crafts and with snacks and all that good stuff. So please contact Ed or myself. Again, that is July 8th to 12th. It will be in the evenings, so we can come from work, get a light dinner, and help out. A couple of more announcements from the school. This Thursday at 5 o'clock, we have an art night for everybody. We will be decorating pots, so flower pots, and then we'll plant a flower in it. And then also, April 21st at 4 o'clock, we have our talent show. So if you have a talent, whether it's a comedian act, a musical talent, reading of poetry, give me a call and let me know, and let's get you signed up. Thanks.
Lots is happening around Klamath Falls. But right now, before we can do anything successfully, let's kneel for prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can call you Father. Thank you that we can worship you today. Thank you that we can praise you. Thank you for the church that you have formed, not just here in Klamath Falls, but the worldwide church that has given birth to our local church here. Lord, we thank you for your word, for your gospel that saves us, that cleanses us, that changes our heart, that gives us hope in these dark and confusing times. And Lord, there are many requests. We've brought them up in our various Sabbath school classes, and there are still others. And we just ask that your healing hand, that your comforting presence would be with everyone, especially those who are not here, and those who are facing temptations and illness and accidents. Lord, we also ask for your blessing upon Ryan as he shares with us. May your word come alive in our hearts and minds today, and may we go forth encouraged and instructed to serve you until the very end, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. It is time for a children's story. If the children want to come up.
Well, when I came in today, I didn't see too many children. I'm hoping we have one. If we don't have anybody, of course, our story will be watched by children at home on television. We have some. Okay. So, Jerry, thank you, Jerry, with that. Before we get started, let's have a prayer for our children, shall we? Bow our heads and acknowledge the wonderful relationship that children have with Jesus. Father, we ask that you guide these young hearts toward you with the Holy Spirit. We entrust you to be their guide and to bless them, and to show them wisdom as they become older. And this is always our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. My favorite Hebrew word. This is not Jaws. But when I was in Mexico, I'm a fisherman, and I've spent a lot of time on the water. But I've only caught one shark. And it, boy, was it a whopper. Man, it was 10 feet long and weighed 500 pounds. And when I caught it, I was holding the fishing rod like this on the edge of the boat, and when the fish hit, it went straight down and trapped my hand between the gunwale, that's the edge of the boat, for all you people that are not fishermen. And it took two deckhands to pull this thing up off my hand. So I didn't have use of it for a few days. And I never got the fish. I got it up to the boat. And they said it was a tiger shark, which is a very dangerous shark. So they had a metal piece of metal to retract the hook. And I got a good look at the shark's teeth. And they go in rows. As they lose teeth, they get another tooth. And a whole set of teeth grows in front as the teeth fall out. So they've always got a sharp tooth. Well, this is not what the point of the story is. That shark was only about 6 to 10 years old. And so it was a juvenile. And they think that sharks like that live about 30 years. But scientists have found a shark in Greenland. And they have aged that to 400 years. Now, the reason they know that is because there's a little bone inside the shark's head that grows a growth ring every year. And when they found the shark, they counted the growth rings, and it was over 400 years old. Now, that means that there's probably sharks out there that are over 400 years old. But that's the oldest living vertebra that we know of. Now, as I said, I'm a fisherman. Could we go to the next slide? There's my favorite bug. That is a mayfly, yellow mayfly, called a hexagena lambata. You don't have to know the name to catch fish with that. And they just gobble those up. Oh, boy, do they like it. It's like a hamburger, you know. And even my dog liked it. And when we take my dog fishing, he'd eat up as many yellow mayflies as he possibly could get. But this is the shortest living creature that we know of on Earth. It only lives 24 hours, and you know why? Because it's born with no mouth. Now, I know a couple of people that I work with that I wish were born with no mouth. I shouldn't say that. They just need to grow up, because what comes out of their mouth, boy, they need some work. Now, this lady is something else. That is Margaret Clement. And she just passed away not too long ago. Margaret Clement lived to be, wait for it, 122 years. So as far as we know in modern times, that's the oldest living human being that we know of, other than Bible times. But there she is. And that picture was taken just before she died, and she was in good health before she died. 122 years old. Well, that's the oldest modern human we know. Now, for the oldest thing on Earth, what do you think it is? Yeah, it is a tree. And it lives in California on the slopes of the Sierra. And they've taken samples, not out of this very one, but they've taken samples and they found a tree that had 5,000 and 24 growth rings. Man, 5,924 growth rings. So that's the oldest living thing we know of on Earth. Now, this jellyfish, I want to tell you about this. First of all, you see those tentacles that are hanging down there? My daughter was swimming in Belize, which is a warm water area, and there was a bunch of these jellyfish, and they had these tentacles that hang down, and she got stung real bad on her leg. So you want to stay away from these things, because that's how they get food. They stun the fish, and then they pull the fish up, and they eat it. But this jellyfish is an unusual jellyfish. It's called the immortal jellyfish. Why would they name it immortal? What does immortality mean? Say it out loud so we can all hear it.
It's not gonna die.
It's not gonna die?
It doesn't. It doesn't. It's immortal. Until something eats it. They have found this jellyfish. There's only one type like this. This jellyfish, when it gets to a certain age, reverts back to a younger age. What is it? You look it up. The immortal jellyfish. There's Ed's checking me here. The immortal jellyfish has given the property by God to regenerate itself. Now, I want to pose the question to you. If God can do this for a jellyfish, what do you think he can do for you? He will let you eat from the tree of life, just like the jellyfish. You get to revert back to a younger age and live forever, just like this jellyfish. Now, isn't that the strangest thing you've ever heard? Thank you. And you can return to your seat now.
Offering this morning is for our local church budget. As the deacons come forward, I'm sure we can all be thankful for our church buildings, for our church family. Some of us have come in because of the expenses that have been paid and the programs that have been funded and the outreach that has happened. So all of that comes under our local church budget. And as we continue to give, God will continue to bless. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, again, we just give you thanks and praise. We thank you for the power to earn money, and we thank you for the heart to give money. Take these offerings, use them as you see fit. Bless your work, increase it until you come. May many souls be encouraged and saved is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath. It's good to see each one of you here this morning. We will be singing together, and I want to share with you, this is Andrew Manthe. He's coming from another church. You may recognize him from the last time he came to join me. All right, we will start with 249. Praise Him, praise Him. And if you'll stand with us, that would be lovely.
Our blessed Redeemer, sing the earth His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him, highest archangels in glory, strength and honor give to His holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard His children. In His arms He carries them all day long. Praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. Praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins He suffered and bled and died. He, our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Hail Him, Jesus the crucified. Beyond His praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows. Love unbounded, wonderful, deep, and strong. Praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. Praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals, loud and hosannas ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown Him, prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming o'er the world victorious. Power and glory unto the Lord belong. Praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song.
It is lovely to see each one of you singing as we praise our Redeemer. We will sing of our Redeemer 343.
I will sing of my Redeemer and His wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross He suffered, from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with His blood He purchased me. On the cross He sealed my pardon, paid the debt, and made me free. Tell the wondrous story, how my lost estate to save. In His boundless love and mercy, He the ransom freely. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with His blood He purchased me. On the cross He sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. Sing of my Redeemer and his heavenly love to me. He from death to life hath brought me, Son of God, with him to be. I'll sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt, and made me free.
Hear what that sounds like. 452.
This is on. The heavenly music steals over the sea, entrancing the senses like sweet melody. To the voice of the angels, home soft on the air, o'er me they are singing, their welcome I hear. On the banks of old Jordan, here gazing I stand, and earnestly longing, I stretch forth my hand. Send a convoy of angels, dear Jesus, I pray. Let me join that sweet music, come take me away. Oh, dark are the waters, and rough is the wave. If Jesus permit the wild surges, I'll brave. For that heavenly music hath ravished me so. I joined in that chorus, I'll go, let me go.
What a beautiful day that will be to see Jesus and to be able to sing with him leading us. We will sing next 424, 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. As we continue to trust in him, we will be able to see him one day soon and hear his sweet melodic voice singing.
Yeah.
Good morning. Let me make some adjustments here. Today I chose to talk about heaven. I don't know about you, but it's one of my favorite subjects. I don't know that you're going to learn anything new, but my hope is that it will be motivation and courage and strength and inspiration to stay the course. Because we all know that living this life here on earth is not an easy one. There won't be any texts on the screen, but I am going to be going through some of them quickly, so you don't necessarily have to look up all of them. But one thing I do have is I do have slides, and they are AI-generated images. Sort of my first time trying to really do much with that. And it's complicated. If you get too specific, you get something awful. It doesn't make sense at all. So it's hard for me. I was hesitant to even use them because I tend to be a very detail-oriented person, and the images I have in my mind, in my head, when I read something are far more better than what I can share here. But I know not everyone is as visual as other people. Different people aren't so much. I guess there's some people that see no images in their head at all, which is strange to me. But if you see something, sometimes when you do, you know, you're typing in a prompt. You're basically creating an image from text that you put in, and sometimes you come up with a lot of, you know, symbols and strange things, and I tried to weed out as much of that as possible, but if there's something I missed, I apologize for that, because I really didn't want it. Something especially about heaven to be tainted with something so earthly and that may have meanings that we don't really know what they are. So, anyways, before we continue and get started here, let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today seeking to learn from your word. Lord, we want to know what it is you have prepared for us. We want to be motivated by what you've taught us and told us and revealed to us. Lord, I'm just a vessel trying to speak your word and share it, and I ask that you send the Holy Spirit to lead me and guide me, and that where I may speak wrong or say something wrong, I ask, Lord, that you reinterpret through your Holy Spirit so that those listening will only hear what you wish for them to hear. And that everyone can learn and take away from this what they need to know. Thank you, Lord, for your love, your care, and your guidance. And thank you for this opportunity that you've given us to one day be restored to the home which you originally prepared for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Well, heaven. What is it like? And do we want to be there? Do we really want to be there? The word heaven is biblically defined in a few different ways. It can be the sky, or what we know as the atmosphere. And it can also be beyond that, what we would call space, the place where the sun, moon, and stars exist. But then it also has a further definition, which we would call the dwelling place of God. In 2 Corinthians, Paul makes mention of the third heaven, and he is talking about the dwelling place of God. So in reading the Bible, when heaven or heavens is mentioned, it could be any one of these three definitions. So for clarity, when I refer to heaven today, I would be referring to the dwelling place of God, unless I specify otherwise. You know, heaven to us is an idea of something that seems absolutely perfect in every way. And many of us can think of it as a the lofty heavens up above, or a place of everlasting bliss. If you look in a dictionary, there are just multiple definitions as to what heaven is, because each culture and each religion has their own ideas about what constitutes happiness or what they expect after death. Many people even have misunderstandings about what the Bible teaches about heaven. And then there's some people that, well, the Bible's portrayal of heaven, well, just doesn't seem that interesting to them. So they redefine heaven to make it more about what they're interested in. But regardless, most of the places you think about in heaven or you read about in the dictionary, they could be called, you know, a paradise or an Eden, but it's too often to each person's own definition. But in wondering on what life in heaven is like, I think a good place to start is at the beginning. So in Genesis 1, verse 1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then jumping down to 7 and 8, it says, and God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven. Today, what the word we use for firmament would be atmosphere. And then it says, in the evening and the morning were the second day. So this isn't the heaven where God dwells, but this is what we call the atmosphere or sky. And going down to verses 14 and 15, it says, and God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. And it was so. So this is talking about the sun, moon, stars, which we know are sort of beyond our atmosphere, the breathable air. And we have in space the sun, moon, and stars. That would be the second heaven that the Bible talks about. And then going to verse 31, it says, and God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Now, when God says something very good, it is very good. It is perfect in every way. And that's what he said about his creation and the creation that he made. It was good and it was perfect. Going to chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, and it says, thus the heavens and the earth were finished and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God had created and made. So we see after creation, God took the time to rest and enjoy and spend time with this new creation that he made, which on the last day he made man. So he took that time and he took it to spend with Adam and Eve. He was, I'm sure, introducing him to his new home, teaching him everything he needs to know, and, you know, and just sort of watching him in wonder as he gets to explore this new environment, you know, that he's completely unfamiliar with and discover, and, you know, it's hard to even imagine. It really is. You know, I don't know if you've ever seen videos of people that have had good vision or been nearly blind, and they're able to, you know, maybe get a good pair of glasses or have a surgery that helps them to see, and all of a sudden they can see things they never saw before, and they're just in amazement everywhere they look. I often think that's maybe the experience that Adam and Eve had. So the Sabbath was a gift to man, and it was a great honor, because God was saying, I want to spend time with you every week on the seventh day. And he confirms that in Mark 2:27, it says, and he said unto them, The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. So going on in verses 4 and 6 of Genesis 2, it says, "These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made the heavens and the earth," I flipped that, "and every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground. But there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground." So the earth at this point, it just grew forth life abundantly. The plants, the trees, the grasses, everything was sustained without any action on the part of man. It was completely self-sustaining. You know, he didn't need to weed, he didn't need to water. I mean, how many of you would like to have that for your gardens now? I know my wife would. She gets really tired of watering. The Garden of Eden was perfect in every way that we could possibly imagine. In verses 8 and 9, it says, "And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge and good and evil." And so we see God taking Adam and Eve, placing them in the special land, the special place he set aside, the Garden of Eden. And it was just for Adam and Eve. And it was, you know, it's like a place that was even more perfect than the creation he had already created. And how does God do that? He creates everything, says it's good, and then he creates this place that's even better to put Adam and Eve into. But I think it even gets more interesting, because in Genesis 2:15, it says, "And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it." So here Adam and Eve are, they're in perfection. What are they going to do to it? How are they possibly going to improve upon it? But that's really sort of what the Lord is asking them to do. They don't have to weed. They don't have to water. You know, I hope I'm not presumptuous in thinking this, but I think in God in creating this garden, he was sort of giving them an example of what could be done. A way of using the existing variety of life to arrange it and display it in a way that can be even more pleasing and more beautiful than it already was. You know, he was sort of saying, here's what you can do with what I've created. And now I want you to take it and do the same type of thing. And this is your home. Customize it. Make it just like you want it to be. You know, the possibilities and the combinations were endless. And the only limit was the imagination of their mind, right? As they cared for this garden, they would be learning about nature and the nature and character of God. And I believe God had much more planned for them, but they didn't remain faithful. So we will never know exactly what it was, at least on this earth, we don't exactly know what would have been in their future, because their time in paradise was cut short by disobedience. In Genesis 3, 23 through 24, it says, "Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of life to the tree of life." But God, in his mercy, he gave Adam and Eve hope of returning to their lost paradise. He told them that the kingdom of Satan would have a limited existence, and that his kingdom and himself, Satan, would one day be destroyed. And since then, there have been two types of people. those that follow Satan and his guidance, or what we would call temptations, and those that follow God and his law in faith and hope of being restored to that paradise. Abraham was one among many that, upon hearing the call of God, left his home and everything familiar to him to wander and dwell in tents. In Hebrew 11, in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 through 10, it says, "By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should, after receive for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out, not knowing where he went, but by faith he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles, or tents, with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God." You know, Abraham left everything he knew, the cities he was familiar with, his relatives, and he left to wander and dwell in tents, looking for this city. A city not built by human hands, not an earthly kingdom, but one built by God. In 13 it says, "These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them." I mean, they were totally convinced that these promises were going to be fulfilled, even though they didn't live to see them. "And confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth." You know, we see the story continue, right? In the Israelites, after leaving Egypt, they were fleeing this land of slavery, and they were looking for a land of their own, a land of promise. And through all their wandering in the wilderness and tents, they were being led by God to a land of promise, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Their journey to a land of promise is representative of God's faithful in the end of time. And it's our journey. We're leaving the slavery and bondage of sin, looking for a land of promise. Not just for a piece of ground, but for that city, just like Abraham, whose builder and maker is God. In Numbers 13:23, it's talking about the children of Israel. "And they came unto the brook of Eshcol, and cut down from thence a branch with one cluster of grapes. And they bare it between two men upon a staff. And they brought of the pomegranates and of the figs." And in verse 27 it says, "And they told him and said, We came unto the land where thou sentest, and surely it flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it." I hope today, as we review these things that we know in the Bibles about heaven, that we gather the grapes and take them and carry these promises with us, so that we will always remember them and keep them before us and use it as a motivator. Israel was to be a beacon on a hill, a light to the rest of the world. They were to demonstrate the goodness of God's law through its economy and its government. It was to be a land of mercy, of righteousness, and of judgment. Had they been faithful to their calling, and at times they were, there were times in their period in history where they were faithful, but then they gradually had a falling away. Israel, though tainted of sin, would never have been heaven, but it could have been a refuge in a sin-sick world, a little taste of heaven on earth. And Israel didn't always fulfill this expectation, but God has always had individuals or people that have been a beacon for him. And thus the followers of Christ, the Christians, took up the torch and became that beacon after Israel. And Continuing in Hebrews 11:16, it says, "But now they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly, whereof God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city." This is a wonderful promise that we have, that all who claim God and confess him before others, that choose to follow Jesus, God will claim as his. He has prepared a home for them. They didn't have to make it. He's done it. And just as he promised, he will return to take us home with him. In 1 Thessalonians 4:16 and 17, it says, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord." So now most of you know this text and are familiar with it, but it's a key point, right? That the dead are raised up, and those who are here on the earth, we will go up and meet our Christ and our Savior in the clouds. He won't be coming into this earth. He won't be placing his feet upon it. So just, you know, remember that as we go on. And in 1 Corinthians 15:52, it says, "In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." Now, this is a great promise. I'm thankful that we're not going to be changed into a jellyfish. Right? But we will be changed into our better selves, a perfect representation of who we are. You know, we will have no more, there will be no more people who are crippled or blind or, you know, whatever problems they had going into the grave, or that they may have had when they saw Christ first coming in the clouds, they won't have anymore. And they will become immortal. In 2 Corinthians 5:1-2, it says, "For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house, which is from heaven." So our earthly body of sin will be no more, and we will be clothed with the righteousness of Christ. Christ, our King, will take us to heaven, and it's just going to be a wonderful experience. It's even hard to imagine, right? But we look forward to that day because we know there's got to be something better than here. But it's going to be a different experience for those who didn't follow Jesus, who didn't choose him. There are going to be those who are wicked who are going to remain, and they're going to have a completely different experience altogether. And unfortunately, there are going to be the great multitude of people on the earth, or the larger number, because it says, you know, broad is the way that leads to destruction, but narrow is the way. Narrow is the straight gate, and few there are that will enter therein. So unfortunately, we know that the wicked are going to be much more plentiful upon the earth. And they will have been united and bent upon the destruction of those that have the faith of Jesus and keep his commandments. When Jesus comes, it gives this in Revelation 6:14-17. It says, "And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman and every freeman hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, Fall on us, hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?" 2 Thessalonians 2:8 says, "And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming." The Lord will consume, because God is a consuming fire, all the wicked left on this earth when he comes, will be destroyed by the brightness of his glory. Then going to Revelation 20, 1 through 3, and it says, I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit, and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more, till 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. Remember that. He must be loosed a little season. So Lucifer, the angel of light, that has made it his purpose and his goal to deceive every one of us on this earth, when the redeemed are taken to heaven, he's going to be bound to this earth. He won't be able to leave. And he won't be able to have anyone left to harass, annoy, or tempt. I hear it. That's good news, isn't it? His power will be gone. He will be a king with no subjects. He will be left to wander this earth and get to see what his decision to violate God's law has led to. But he will only be there for 1,000 years, and then he will be let loose once more. So while he's staying there, let's get back to see what God's people are doing, since they are now out of the reach of Satan. Okay, in Revelation 15, 2 to 3, it says, And I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of gold. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, Great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. As we sang that hymn today about singing on the sea of glass, I hope that's a song that we sing as well. And I hope we could sing it there with James White. I don't know if anyone noticed that, but he was the one that wrote that. Jesus will give all those who overcome a crown on their heads, a new name to reflect their new body, and it'll reflect, you know, the righteous life that you will now live forever and evermore. Everyone will have a right to enter the heavenly city. The privilege of eating from the tree of life will be restored, and they will be given power over the nations. But not the power we see here on earth of man over man, but the power of God that is revealed as a servant. In Matthew 19, 28 through 30, it says, And Jesus said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye also shall sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone that has forsaken houses, or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my name's sake, shall receive 100-fold, and shall inherit everlasting life. But many that are first shall be last, and the last shall be first. And then in Revelation 20, 4 through 7, it says, And I saw thrones, and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them, And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, and neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead lived not again until 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that has part in the first resurrection. On such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. So we see the redeemed are going to be involved in a judgment in these texts. And, you know, it's not a judgment like it's already going on right now with Jesus, because when Jesus comes again the second time, he already has determined who is wicked and who is righteous. And he brings his reward for those who are righteous. But Jesus is very thorough. He never wants this problem of sin again, right? It originated in heaven, and he never wants it to originate again. He wants it to be settled once and for all. So it must be established by two or more witnesses. Or in this case, all the redeemed of the earth. They will establish that all the decisions that Jesus made were just. You know, they went through everything all these other people have to be going through, and they will be able to look and see, yes, God judged righteously with every single one. And during that time, they will be able to find out, why are some of these people that we thought would be here, why aren't they? And there's going to be some there, they're going to be, wow, I did not expect to see you here. You know, praise the Lord, but yeah, I really didn't expect that. But, you know, this is part of the process to ensure that sin never occurs in paradise again. In Revelation 21, 2 through 3, we see a vision of John in the New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall lead them and be their God. Jesus said that he must go and prepare a place for us. But this place is not for us only. It is a place where he can dwell with us. There won't be a temple that represents God within the city, because God himself will physically be there by his presence, face to face. In Revelation 21, 10 through 14, it says, the holy Jerusalem descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, and her like was unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. I always thought of jasper when I read this as being green in color. And I looked it up. What is a jasper? I just wanted to be sure in that. And I found out I was very wrong. It can be. It can be green, like an emerald. But they can also be red, brown, orange, white. So what is it trying to say? What I figured out is it's just trying to say that the city will have a polished appearance like jasper. So it'll be a polished crystal city. And continuing on, reading on, it says, and it had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates. And at the gates, 12 angels, and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. On the east, 3 gates, and on the north, 3 gates. On the south, 3 gates, and on the west, 3 gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And he measured the wall thereof, 144 cubits, according to the measure of a man, that is, of an angel. It says 144 cubits, but it doesn't really specify, is that how tall it is? Is that how wide it is? 144 cubits equates to 216 feet, or 72 yards, so about 3/4 of the length of a football field. According, as we go on, we'll look at some of the other measurements of the city, and I think this is actually probably the width, but I don't really know. You know, a lot of it we're just going to discover when we get there, right? In verse 18, it says, and the building of the wall of it was jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. Well, it's clear like crystal, but now it says pure gold like glass, so we may need to change it a little bit. Shows a wall at least. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, third chalcedony, the fourth an emerald, fifth a sardonyx, the sixth a sardius, seventh chrysolite, beryl, topaz, chrysoprasus, I don't even know how to say it, jacinth, amethyst. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was of one pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass. I don't know if any of you have seen, but there's some tourist locations in the world where they, Grand Canyon comes to mind, where they have this platform of glass that extends over the edge of the canyon. Or I think they even have some places that have bridges of glass where you can see directly what's beneath you. And most people are incredibly terrified of these places to walk over where they can't see anything actually holding them up. I don't think we're going to have that problem in heaven. I think we're all going to feel perfectly at home there. It says, and I saw a temple. I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it. For the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. Okay. Then it goes on and tells us the city lies foursquare. This is verse 16 of chapter 21. And the length is as large as the breadth. So it's a square. It's describing equal on all sides. Perfect square. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. So I was wondering, what's 12,000 furlongs? And I figured out it's 1,500 miles. But, you know, it's not real specific. Is this each side 1,500 miles? Or the whole circumference 1,500 miles, the whole perimeter? And, you know, it's not real clear. If it was the total length, and it was 1,500 miles all the way around, that would make each side 375 miles in length. The length, the breadth, and the height of it are equal. So whatever the width of it, whatever one length of one side is, it's just as tall. So if it's 375 miles for one side of it, it's going to be 375 miles tall in height. Or if it's 1,500 miles, that'd be 1,500 miles in height. With God, anything is possible. Scholars on this are completely split. There's some that think one way and some that think the other. So what I decided to do is, for comparison, I'm just going to take the smaller size. Take the 375 miles per side and, you know, see how that works out. There's some people that say, well, that's not possible. There's no way it could hold all the redeemed righteous from the beginning of time. It's just, it definitely can't be that small, right? Does anyone know how many people are in the world today? I think I heard it. Around 8 billion, they estimate. No one really knows exactly. Well, this is interesting, but you could take every one of those 8 billion people and put them within the state of Connecticut. Every single person that's alive on the earth right now could fit within the state of Connecticut. And, you know, Connecticut's not a big state. I've blown it up here, so it probably looks a little larger than it is, but it's only 110 miles wide and 70 miles from top to bottom. It's not a very big state. And the people would not be crammed in there like sardines. Did the math on this, and you would actually have 20 square feet per person. So that means that if everyone was standing, of 8 billion people within the state of Connecticut, you'd have 20 feet between you and the next person. There's no way any infrastructure that we have could ever support that many people in one place. It just wouldn't be possible. But with God, the infrastructure is not a problem. But the whole state of Connecticut could fit into the New Jerusalem over 18 times. Only God knows the number of those who will be redeemed. And I'm sure whatever it is, God has made the city large enough. I've no doubt about that. But continuing on with this, the New Jerusalem, 75 miles, 375 miles per side, I decided to compare it with territory that's familiar to us. So I started one corner right here at this address in Klamath Falls at our church. And if you follow one wall directly south, it would extend pretty much right into the center of Monterey Bay. Not in the water, but right on the edge of Monterey Bay, on the land still. This isn't a perfect representation of it, but and that would be one corner. The next corner would extend almost to Vegas. Not quite there. The good news is Vegas, Sin City, will be outside of the city. Okay. Then the next wall would extend up about 20 miles west of Twin Falls, Idaho. And then it would come back to here in Klamath Falls. Now, some of you I know have driven over this kind of area, and you have some concept of how big of a region that is. It's huge. It's immense. If you look at the map, I mean, does it show? I think it shows Utah there. Pretty much all of Utah would fit in that square. No problem. I mean, it's just a big, big chunk of ground. Okay, if you were to drive one length of that 375 miles, it's an average of 60 miles an hour, it would take you 6 hours and 15 minutes without stopping to go that full distance. To do a complete circuit, to go around the whole perimeter of city walls, it would take 25 hours at 60 miles an hour. So, I mean, it's relative to what we know today, this is just huge. There's nothing like it, of course, on this earth. But in Zechariah 14:4, it says, "And his feet shall stand on that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east, and on the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east, and the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof towards the east and towards the west. And there shall be a very great valley, and half the mountain shall move towards the north, and half of it towards the south." Remember, Jesus won't set foot on this earth at his second coming. So this would have to be when he returns to the earth with the new Jerusalem. And this is a description of him making a section of land that's vast enough and large enough, a great plain, where this new Jerusalem can come down. This great valley is created for the city to sit in the midst. And it can't be within current day Israel, because a city this size would be larger than the whole country of Israel. So it can't be within it. It would have to completely, you know, take it over, basically, you might say. That whole perimeter, the country of Israel, would fit with inside of. And this isn't even to scale. It would actually be much smaller within that square, because the whole country of Israel is about 75 miles wide and 265 miles long. So that just gives you a perspective, some perspective, on at least the smaller number that we have in the Bible of how large this new Jerusalem is going to be, at a minimum. So going on in Revelation 27 through 8, and it says, "And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. The dead wicked will be resurrected," as we saw earlier in verse 5, "after the 1,000 years. And they will be a vast throng arrayed around the city. They will be far superior in numbers to those who are within the city. Those who crucified, pierced, and spit on Jesus will see him as a glorious king. The wicked will see the followers of Christ within the city, those that they mocked, ridiculed, persecuted, and tortured. And all the wicked will acknowledge Jesus as the Messiah, the Son of David, the King of Kings." It won't be a confession of repentance, but it'll be one of bitterness. In Zechariah 12:10, it says, "And I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplications. And they shall look upon me whom they have pierced. And they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. You know, to acknowledge someone as better, as holy, in bitterness is sort of in regret, right? Regret that they were wrong and wish they had been right. But their hearts never changed. They weren't ever at any point really aligned with God. Or if they had, they fell away. But Satan now has his subjects back. He has his power back because he has power over them. In Revelation 28, it says, "And he shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea." The wicked will come out of the grave, not transformed like we hope to be, but they will have the same characters that they had when they went in. They will have the same desires. They will have the same passions. They will not have the bloom of immortal life. They will be however they went into the grave. However grotesque they went in, they will be coming out just in that same way. They will still have all the same problems and all the maladies that were affecting them before will be affecting them afterwards. It will be a gruesome sight. But they were used to following Satan, and they will follow him once more. Satan will rouse them forward to take the city, and it will be seen once more that Jesus made no mistakes in his judgment, because the wicked have shown themselves to be of the same character that they were, you know, that they showed before. Even though they know God is king, they're still going to go and try to take the city for themselves. The good news is they have no chance. In Revelation 29 through 10, it says, "And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Each of the wicked, including the devil, will receive their reward," which is their punishment, "each according to his own wicked ways, until they are all consumed. The stain of sin will forever be removed, and we will never have this issue again. There will never be sin anymore. It will be destroyed, consumed, and gone away. The results of that are for eternity." Now what comes is the best part, I think. Okay. In Revelation 21:1, it says, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new." All things new. "And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful." You know, when it talks about no more sorrow, no more tears, no more crying, I really think that's after the wicked are destroyed, because I think there's still going to be a grief in our heart and sorrow for maybe those loved ones that didn't choose Christ, that chose not to follow him. But I think that's the last time we may shed a tear for those who are lost. We will get to see our Savior and our Creator recreate the earth. And after each day when he says it is good, we can shout hallelujah and break into song. You know, something that we have to take by faith now, we are actually going to get to see happen. So I just think that's great. In Isaiah 66, 22 through 23, it says, "For as the new heavens and the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your seed and your name remain. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, says the Lord." So what is life going to look like in this new earth? or maybe heaven, right? Because now it becomes the dwelling place of God. It will be paradise. It will be heaven. God is going to dwell with us. Okay. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, there was the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and her servant shall serve him, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. And there shall be no night there. They need no candle, nor light of the sun, for the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. So in Isaiah 11, 6 through 9, it gives us sort of a picture of what this new earth is going to look like. It says, the wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid. And the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. And the cow and the bear shall feed. Their young ones shall lie down together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox. In these next verses, when I this is probably one spot where the images generated surpassed my expectations. Maybe it's because I don't like snakes. I don't know, but I'm just warning you. I sort of actually found these somewhat disturbing. And maybe it's because of our perceived perceptions, but it says, and the sucking child shall play in the hole of the asp. And the weaned child shall put his hand on the cobra's den. But they shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. And then in Isaiah 65, 19 through 25, it says, and I will rejoice in Jerusalem, and joy in my people. And the voice of weeping shall be no more heard in her, nor the voice of crying. There shall be no more an infant of days. We won't have to worry about kids dying before they get old, before they get, you know, from sickness or anything else. It says, nor will there be an old man that has not filled his days. For the child shall die at 100 years old. So what that's basically saying is that we will be considered a child until we're at least 100. I mean, now that's just unknown, right? Because it says, but the sinner being 100 years old will be accursed. You know, now if we reach 100, it's a pretty amazing thing. You know, not everyone reaches 120 like that lady that Tom showed us earlier. So, you know, we won't have those worries anymore of dying. We will all live forever. Okay? And they shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat the fruit of them. They shall not build and another inhabit, and they shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree are the days of my people. Does anyone remember how old that tree was that Tom showed us in the picture this morning? I think it was 5,000 some years, right? So here it's saying their days will be like the days of a tree. They will be, you know, it's basically a good way of saying eternity. And mine elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth trouble, for they are the seed of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring with them. And it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they are yet speaking, I will hear. And the wolf and the lamb shall feed together. And the lion shall eat straw like the bullock. And the dust shall be the serpent's meat. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, says the Lord. You know, the fact of the matter is that the words of inspiration, even within the Bible, are simply inadequate of sharing with us the glories that we can expect in heaven. Our language and our understanding are even incapable of describing heaven. What has been revealed to us is but a mere glimpse of what awaits those who are righteous. In 1 Corinthians 2:9 it says, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. I've been careful to present what the Bible says about heaven and not to present my own ideas or others' ideas. But there is plenty of room for our imagination to expand on what the possibilities of heaven may be. But we need to be careful that we don't try to reinterpret heaven according to our own sin-depraved ideas. But I think the most important thing we can take away from what we've learned about heaven today is that Jesus, our Savior, our God, and our Creator, will be dwelling with us. We will talk, learn, and discover the wonders that are in store for us side by side with Him and face to face with Him. For Him, it's going to be an experience like when He first created Adam and Eve, right? He's going to get them watch and discover and learn all these wonders once more. But, you know, if we're not now accustomed to spending time with Him, if we're not setting the time apart each day to read His Word, if we're not spending time with Him in prayer and speaking to Him as a friend, if we aren't accustomed to joining together with fellow believers on Sabbath to worship Him, if we are not used to submitting our will to His, if we are not used to doing these things, then we are making a decision that heaven is not for us. Because the key point is that our Savior is going to be there and we're going to get to spend time with Him. So if we're not doing it now, we need to, if we want to be there. If we want to be in heaven with Him, we need to be spending the time with Him now. See, heaven is going to be full of people that love and trust Jesus. They will be daily seeking to serve God and each other. We are a group of believers, a community right here in this church. And if we make Jesus the focus of our personal lives and in our homes, then we can be a little heaven on earth. We can be that beacon on the hill, showing the rest of the world what the coming kingdom will be like. Heaven's going to be wonderful, not because of what we have, but it'll be about who we have with us there to share the experience. We will have faith in Jesus and in the plans that He has for us for all of eternity. If He has a plan for us now, I know He's got plans for us up there. And, you know, I hear people say, you know, heaven, it just sounds like a boring place. You know, and to me, that's showing a lack of trust and faith in our Savior. Because we need to trust that He will be leading us, guiding us, and have a plan for us. We will never have to fear boredom. The good news is there's room for everyone. We're all told to come as we are, to submit our heart and will to Christ. And that is not always a pleasant and easy experience. But just like coal is subjected to intense heat and pressure to become a diamond, so Christ can transform us into the person that He desires us to spend, so that we will want to spend eternity with Him, and that we will love to be by His side. We will have that desire for a city and whose builder and maker is God. Paige will now have our closing hymn.
Please stand with us. Our closing hymn is 428.
Presence on the Sabbath day, Lord, help us to not really leave it, but continue it. Help us, Lord, to recommit our lives to you day by day, to serve and to follow you, to be your servants in the sin-sick world. Lord, we want to spend heaven with you. We want to be there for eternity. And Lord, this is the hope that we have, to be restored to what was once lost. And the biggest part of that is you. So, Lord, please put that desire within our hearts to seek, to love, to learn you, to search out your will and your word, to follow all that you teach us. Lord, you know, we're a broken people in a broken world, and we can't do this alone. We need your help. It's only with your help that we're ever going to make it. Thank you for all that you've promised to do for us. And just help us to stay the course, to put our faith and trust in you day by day, to be in the practice of you, testing you and trying you over and over. Thank you, Lord. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.